Soviet Empire. Mount Ararat rises to nearly 17,000 feet, covering 24 square miles. For a personal perspective of this forbidding mountain and its endless challenges, we visited with Dr. John Morris, a geology professor who has led 13 expeditions to Mount Ararat.
I've climbed mountains all over the world, but Mount Ararat is, I guess, it's brutal. It's just the worst I've ever climbed. Actually, from the south side, when you look at the mountain, it looks like a nice volcanic cone, but then on the opposite side, there's this incredible canyon called the Ohora Gorge. It's about 1.5 times the height of the Grand Canyon. There are vertical rock walls. I'm convinced they're unclimbable. It's covered with an ice cap year-round, and that ice cap is always eroding these volcanic layers, producing avalanches down below as it erodes along. Every afternoon there's a storm up on the mountain, and the winds sometimes are over 100 miles an hour.
But neither the ominous legends nor the lethal hazards of the climb have ever deterred the thousands of determined answer seekers. They have been challenging the mountain for hundreds of years.
We know that the Chaldean high priest and historian Berossus visited the site about 475 BC, where he wrote considerably of the phenomena he witnessed, stating that it was quite easy to discern the Ark in its resting place high up on the glacier.
Hieronymus, the Egyptian historian of 30 BC, who authored an ancient history of Phoenicia, mentions the Ark's existence on Mount Ararat. Also in the same period, Nicholas of Damascus, the biographer of Herod the Great, told of the Ark's landing near the summit of Ararat and reported that timbers were still there.
Many, many celebrated men of antiquity made journeys to the awesome mountain. One of these was Epiphanius, the saintly bishop of Salamis in 360 AD, who was shown an already treasured relic of the Ark, a well-preserved and identifiable piece of a seagoing vessel structure. Armenian historian Hython said he himself saw the Ark in 1254. He wrote, "At the summit of Mount Ararat, a great black object is visible, the Ark of Noah." In 1269 AD, renowned explorer Marco Polo wrote in his book, The Travels, that Noah's Ark rests high in the snowy reaches of Mount Ararat.
There is plenty of ancient historical evidence spanning nearly 2,000 years that the Ark is on Mount Ararat. These sightings recorded by prominent historians of the time, along with eyewitness accounts, add significant credibility to the survival of the Ark on Mount Ararat.
According to the Bible, the Lord instructed Noah to build the ark of gopher wood in order to survive the flood. Obviously, gopher wood had to be very strong. Exactly what kind of wood was it?
Gopher wood is a process rather than a species. In Israel, in the olden days, they had a particular tree. They would cut the bark, collect the sap, and use it as glue and spice wood together. Once it hardened, you could not break the splice. The wood would break on either side. We don't have a ply tree, but we have plywood. What if gopher wood is a process and a laminated process?
Whether or not this process was used, the vessel was going to have to be incredibly strong because of its immense proportions. A length of 300 cubits by 50 cubits of width and 30 cubits of height, the cubit being about 18 inches. Just how big was it?
It had 1,500,000 cubic feet of space inside, which is the equivalent of 170 railroad boxcars. The Ark should be thought of in this perspective. Think of a four-story apartment building almost a block long, and you've got it.
God told Noah to make the Ark with lower, middle, and upper decks. The construction of the Ark continued over many years. Noah's neighbors came to laugh and scorn as Noah and his family worked toward completion. The construction by hand of a floating vessel of these huge dimensions boggles the mind. How was it possible for Noah to have built the Ark on such a grand scale as recorded in the Bible without the use of modern technology?
If we look at the evidence left to us by ancient civilizations, we find that the further back we go, the more amazing are the accomplishments. The ancient Minoans were highly advanced. Some of the reconstructions of their temples that were destroyed catastrophically reveal that they had tremendous abilities, architectural skills and artistic design. We see their inlaid stone, natural ventilation and air conditioning. We could go to Egypt and look at some of their artifacts, some of which are electroplated. Such electroplated artifacts have been found literally around the ancient world. The ancients were also able to make batteries and generate electricity. The ancient Mayans were able to calculate the solar year to be 365.2420 days, accurate to within 2/10,000 of a day.
From this information, we can easily draw the conclusion that, in fact, ancient man had a highly developed technology, easily sufficient to build a vessel the size of Noah's Ark. By the mid-19th century, global communications helped to shrink the world significantly. This brought Western civilization more information, along with speculation and rumor about reported sightings of Noah's Ark. In 1829, a Russian-born German physician named Friedrich Perret was the first Western explorer on record to scale Mount Ararat. Prior to the climb, Perret visited the Armenian cathedral at Echmiadzin in Soviet Armenia. There he viewed the cross, which was claimed to be carved of wood brought down from Noah's Ark in 318 AD. Perret wrote that the carving measured 12 inches high, 9 inches across, and was brownish in color. From Echmiadzin, Perret climbed to the 7,000-foot level of the mountain, where he reached Ahura village. This was where the St. Jacob Monastery was located. There he saw ancient manuscripts and relics from the Ark. Perret continued on all the way to the summit of Mount Ararat, but had no success in locating the Ark. In June 1840, 11 years after Perret's expedition, Mount Ararat suffered a tremendous earthquake. And most of the 2,000 homes and buildings in the area were destroyed by the earthquake. Survivors were few. The St. Jacob Monastery and the relics it held literally disappeared under an avalanche of rocks from the shattered mountain, leaving behind the Ahura Gorge, a rugged canyon deeper than the Grand Canyon. Throughout the 1800s, adventurers, explorers, and people of faith continued expeditions to seek out the Ark. Hermann von Abisch climbed to the Ararat summit in 1845, and two major glaciers on the mountain have been named after him. Colonel Kodzko of the Russian army conquered the peak in 1850. An Englishman, Major Robert Stewart, made his climb in 1845. There are people who find difficulty in believing accounts of the past merely because the stories are old. But can there be any doubt that at least some of the 19th century Ark seekers actually saw the Ark and brought back proof of its existence? Can skeptics simply write off this vast number of eyewitness accounts and sightings?
I have studied virtually every known historical sighting of the Ark on Mount Ararat. Over the past 150 years, many of these accounts of the sightings have gone into considerable detail. I have compared 34 of these sightings, and I found that there is a tremendous consistency between eyewitnesses, even though they never knew each other. We can choose to believe that all of these reports are based upon lies or based upon the information presented by the eyewitness accounts. We can choose to believe that the Ark or some large wooden barge is on Mount Ararat if just one of these reports is true.
With the completion of the great boat, God commanded Noah to bring unto the ark two of all living creatures, male and female. Wouldn't the gathering of the animals have been a virtually impossible task? A feat beyond all probability?
The Bible says the animals shall come to the ark. In this case, we wonder how the
animals knew to come to this location. We think that instinctively they sensed from what was going on around about them that this impending disaster was about to happen. And as a result, they were led or even driven to seek a place of safety. Hence, the animals came to the ark.
Even with the enormous size of Noah's floating vessel, many serious questions arise that clearly challenge the credibility of the entire ark story.
The question I would ask is quite simple. How could two of every living animal be brought aboard any vessel? The sheer numbers and weight would overwhelm a fleet of arks. I don't believe we can take the story of the ark literally.
Actually, the biblical record does not say that every species of animal in the world was in the ark. Many kinds were in the ocean, whales and marine creatures of various types, and of course, the major insect varieties in the world were not included either. From studies that I and others have done, we estimate there could have been from 2,500 to 20,000 different kinds of animals taken aboard Noah's Ark.
Each family of creatures on the Earth today have a single pair of ancestors. For example, even though there are over 300 varieties of dogs in the world today due to selective breeding, they have a single common ancestor. Considering the number of kinds of animals required to be put aboard the Ark, there would have been ample room to load the ancestors of all the species we know today, with room left over for Noah's family, food, and supplies.
When we return...
The next 10 years of my life were spent putting together these ancient clay tablets, but it was more than a complicated jigsaw puzzle.
How one man's astonishing discovery brought the scientific world's attention to the real truth about Noah's Ark. All the ancient accounts and reported sightings, most people over the years felt that the Ark story was just an old legend. Part of the problem was that there was only one widely known written account of Noah's Ark, the Holy Bible. The credibility of the biblical story of Noah got a big boost from an unlikely source in a most accidental fashion from this man. In the mid-1800s, George Smith, an engraver by trade, used to spend his lunch hours in the British Museum.
I was not a trained archaeologist, but I had an endless fascination for things of an historical nature. My special interest was with artifacts of ancient Assyria. Though I'd never been to that part of the world, I'd read extensively everything available on Middle Eastern cultures and was utterly captivated by the subject.
As a frequent visitor, Smith had struck up a friendship with the museum director, who was impressed by the man's intelligence and enthusiasm. Smith was offered a special job. Someone was needed to piece together some of the 25,000 clay cuneiform tablets unearthed in the ancient city of Nineveh dating back to the 6th century BC.
The next 10 years of my life were spent putting together these ancient clay tablets, but it was more than a complicated jigsaw puzzle. The inscriptions I translated from those tablets had a profound effect on the world of archaeology.
In 1872, after a decade of work, Smith came upon an account of a ship surviving a great flood and its coming to rest on a mountain, of a dove being sent out and not finding a place to land. The story told in these tablets, known as the Gilgamesh Epic, paralleled exactly the story of Noah in the Bible, suggesting the biblical account is far more than a fictional legend. George Smith's startling findings stirred great scientific curiosity and rekindled enormous public interest about the Ark and its possible discovery. This led to many attempts by adventurers and explorers of the times to climb Mount Ararat in search of the Ark. In 1876, James Bryce, a highly regarded British statesman, jurist, and author, journeyed to Mount Ararat. There, Bryce began the first recorded solo attempt to scale the mountain. On his trek, he discovered a 4-foot-long, 5-inch-thick, partially petrified piece of hand-hewn timber. It was found at the snow-covered 14,000-foot level. Major newspapers of the day, including the New York Times, published Bryce's story, indicating his discovery of Noah's Ark. But Darwin's new theory of evolution was just then gaining in popularity. The Bryce account, which supported traditional religious thought, was largely ignored. In 1883, an expedition was sent on to Mount Ararat by the Turkish government to survey damage from a recent earthquake. The expedition team reported the discovery of the forepart of a very old ship jutting out of the ice 14,000 feet up the mountain. Measurements were taken, the ark was entered, and the team reported seeing several stalls and cages inside the great vessel. Unfortunately, the Turkish report stirred very little international interest, once again because of the current popularity of Darwin's new theory of evolution. The long task of gathering the animals into the ark was nearing completion. "Go into the ark, you and your whole family," God told Noah, "because I have found you righteous in this generation." Those who came to witness the spectacle considered it nothing but folly. God's vow echoed for Noah. In 7 days he would send down rains from the heavens and wipe from the face of the earth every living creature he had made. With many regrets and no real alternatives, Noah reluctantly closed the door to the great ark. The people continued to mock Noah, unaware of the devastation and death that lie ahead.
Be the start of it.
Beyond anything they could have imagined. Their scorn was forgotten as their concern turned to fear. Even among the eight on board, uncertainty was growing.
We can't allow them to perish. Certainly we have enough provisions to bring those poor souls on board.
You know how I wish we could do what you're saying. But there's some bigger purpose, some bigger plan we're all part of. It's not in our hands to change that.
Noah's heart went out to them, but he knew he had no choice but to follow God's commands.
The ark itself. What was it designed to do during the flood? Was it capable of carrying out its assigned life-saving tasks? Could a seagoing vessel built to the Ark specifications endure a 40-day-long cloudburst and survive in a violent storm-tossed sea for months on end? Would the Ark be sound and stable in the water? Some scholars completely reject the idea that a wooden boat the size of Noah's Ark would be at all seaworthy.
When it comes to the design and construction of the biblical Ark, there are several important reasons it could not have existed. First, the technology needed simply did not exist. Second, any modern vessel today would have certainly foundered in far less weather conditions than the biblical deluge. It is highly unlikely Noah's wooden ark would have survived more than a few hours under such conditions.
To examine this issue ourselves, we took a model of the ark to a marine laboratory to see how it would handle waves and other hydraulic stresses. When subjected to the irregular waves generally found on the ocean, the ark was deemed not only seaworthy, but exceptionally stable. Then the test tank duplicated waves equivalent to 200-foot tidal waves. Again, the ark was not only seaworthy, but extraordinarily stable.
You can show that the balance between the buoyant force and the gravitational force and the wave force and so on would be such that the ark would right itself if it were tilted anywhere up to 90 degrees, anywhere from 0 to 90 degrees, in other words. The righting effect would be such that it would just come right back up again. It'd be practically impossible to capsize.
So it appears the Ark was indeed a highly reliable seagoing vessel. It is all the more remarkable for one simple fact. No larger ship was built on Earth for over 4,000 years.
When our discovery of Noah's Ark continues, startling eyewitness accounts tell of a large wooden ship resting high on the snowy reaches of Mount Ararat.
George Agopian, after a four-year drought, went up and saw the Ark completely exposed.
But I'm convinced at this time that I was looking at Noah's Ark.
Coming to the Ark, and now here I was, actually standing on it. Nearby, I could see a hole had been cut in the roof. So I went to it and looked inside. It was just too dark in there to see anything at all. There were pieces broken off here and there, but it was still very solid to walk on. Along the side of the raised section in the middle, there were openings like windows, but there was nothing I could see.
Years after the event, George Hagopian described what he had seen to archaeological illustrator Dr. Alfred Lee.
Up here, George Hagopian, after a four-year drought, went up with his uncle and saw the ark completely exposed. He also noticed along the side here the wood grain, beautifully fitted joints with wooden dowels. He could see the color of the grain. It was not a stone formation. It was definitely a man-made wooden construction.
All these pieces of beams and wooden planking gleaned from the slopes of Ararat over the centuries seems to beg a question. Being so old, what kind of condition could the Ark be in now?
There's been a tremendous earthquake. There's been a great crevasse created here, and a big avalanche. And the Ark has split into two pieces. And this is what is being seen today.
This, in fact, points up one of the great mysteries having to do with the Ark. We wonder, how can the Ark, presumably spotted by one person, is not easily found when others go looking for it? Well, certainly this would seem to make the occasional reports of Ark sightings quite suspect. So we went looking for answers to this mystery.
This photograph, which was taken by the French Spot satellite in August 1986, indicates that Mount Ararat, pictured here, is permanently year-round covered with glacial ice. On Mount Ararat, there are, of course, seasonal changes in the weather. The chances of seeing the Ark are greatly increased during the warm months of late summer, such as in August or September. However, there are warmer weather cycles occurring every few years, which cause increased meltback of the snow-covered summit. It's possible and probably likely that the Ark is only visible or accessible during these infrequent periods of warmer temperatures. An expedition coming to find the Ark could walk directly over the icebound ship and never know that it's there.
It stayed dark and overcast during the long storm. So the first appearance of sunlight was a revelation.
The sun! Everyone, come quickly! Do you see?
Sunlight. It's time to open the hatch.
Not yet, I'm afraid. The Lord will reveal his true plan for us in due time.
In fact, they would continue to be afloat aboard the Ark for another 7 months. There were only 8 human passengers aboard the Ark, yet there were several thousand animals to feed and attend to during those many months at sea. It seemed like a nearly impossible task. Could it have been done?
In the Ark, we would expect that there would be a lot of darkness, mainly due to the storm above. Under these conditions, the animals on the Ark would probably feed less, sleep more, and in many cases, we would expect that they would be in hibernation. Combine this quieting with lack of feed, sleeping, darkness, all of this would go together so that the family of Noah would be more than adequate to care for the animals for even up to a year.
It was in 1916 when the history of Ark sightings took another important turn. Shortly after World War I, a Russian pilot, Lieutenant Zabolotsky, told his remarkable story of sighting the Ark on Mount Ararat in 1916.
I was stationed with a small group of aviators about 25 miles northeast of Mount Ararat. A new high-altitude engine had been installed in one of the planes, and I was sent up for test flight. When I circled the mountain, I spotted a dark structure there. Huge. Something the size of a battleship. It was a strange-looking craft, but quite clearly a boat with a rounded-over top.
News of Lieutenant Zabolotsky's sighting reached Tsar Nicholas himself. In 1917, the Tsar dispatched 2 companies of soldiers to locate and document this extraordinary find. The soldiers found and measured the Ark. They also made a photographic record of the great ship. Unfortunately, these events were unfolding just as the Communist Revolution was breaking out at home. As a result, the reports and photos of this expedition have yet to be found and are presumed lost.
Or hidden in some secret Kremlin vault. However, they were seen.
Megan Butler, managing editor of Regnery Gateway Publishers in Washington, D.C., recently published the book Anastasia. It tells the life story of the Russian Tsar's daughter.
There's been controversy about whether or not there ever was a Russian expedition or an Ark sighting around the time of 1916 or 1917. Our author spent 20 years researching Anastasia, the last surviving member of the Russian royal family. During one of his personal conversations with her, he was shocked when she started talking about an expedition which her father, the Tsar, had commissioned to go to Mount Ararat and measure and photograph Noah's Ark. She told him she'd actually seen the photographs and the report from the expedition. She also told him she'd worn a cross made from the wood of Noah's Ark.
During World War II, Allied pilots flew many missions in the vicinity of Mount Ararat.
I was in North Africa stationed with the Signal Installation Battalion doing work for the Army Air Force. A flyer, a good friend of mine, he and I decided to have a cup of coffee one evening. And while in the officers' mess, overheard the conversation of a couple of other officers concerning pictures they took when they were flying over Turkey and over Mount Ararat. And As they looked at the pictures, we become interested and started to look at them too. And some of them said, you know, these could be Noah's Ark. Let me tell you what I saw in these three pictures. First of all three pictures depicted an ice flow that came down over the boat in an angle of something like this. The ice came down. But in this part, as you look at it from the right side, there was an opening down here where it had been tore away. And I could see the various, about one and two layers here, and also a structure along the side here. There was no question in the minds of these flyers that this was Noah's Ark. And a similar picture was put in the Stars and Stripes in about 1944. But I'm convinced at this time that I was looking at Noah's Ark. There's no question in my mind, and the flyers felt the same way.
When we continue...
I couldn't understand what they were saying, but it was pretty clear they wanted us out of our tents.
A team of explorers ascends Mount Ararat in search of the Ark. As they approach the discovery site, their trek takes a surprising turn.
I can tell you this, there was a lot of praying going on right about then. We really pretty much thought this is it.
15 cubits upward, and all the high mountains under the entire heavens were covered. At a depth of 15 cubits, the highest mountain peaks on Earth would have been covered by more than 20 feet of water. Flooding is a natural phenomenon of nature. Few parts of the world are free from its savage effects. But the biblical account of the Noah's flood tells of a great worldwide disaster, a global deluge requiring billions upon billions of cubic feet of water. Can we find any proof at all that it really happened?
Floods, both great and small, are an integral part of this planet's nature. There are many indications of floods in antiquity, but I personally would question one single massive flooding that covered the entire Earth in water for 150 days.
There's an extensive amount of evidence for a global universal flood catastrophe, and I see most of that evidence in the fossil record. Worldwide, fossils of animals and fish have been found buried in swimming positions suddenly and catastrophically, preserved in a moment of time. Among the most fascinating fossil finds which show animals in swimming positions include rhinos, hippos, and zebras buried in volcanic ash in Nebraska. And in Scotland, tons of fish have been found in positions of terror, fins extended and eyes bulging. Another fossil graveyard, this one in Geiseltal, Germany, shows a mixture of plants and insects from all climatic zones. When these kinds of fossils are found together, this is usually indicative of global flooding and rapid burial.
And what about Mount Ararat itself? I mean, where the Bible claims the Ark went aground, if it had been submerged underwater, as the Bible says all mountaintops were, can we see any evidence that this actually happened?
I've noticed two things in particular on Mount Ararat from a geologic point of view that indicates that this 17,000-foot volcanic mountain was once underwater. First is the occurrence, high on Mount Ararat, of what is called pillow lava. Pillow lava is a unique formation that occurs when molten lava emerges from the earth below water. This alone indicates that the mountain was at one time underwater. Secondly, we have found salt crystals on Mount Ararat which could only be formed underwater. These salt crystals were found at the 14,000-foot elevation, indicating that, at least up to the permanent ice and snow line, that this mountain was underwater at one point.
And so the evidence mounts, indicating that, yes, there likely was indeed massive worldwide flooding. It appears more and more that the events surrounding the biblical story of Noah may in fact be true. The devastating worldwide flood of Noah, along with the legendary 40 days and 40 nights of rain, is one of the Bible's most enduring and dramatic stories. But to accept the story of the flood as truth, we're faced with some very tough questions. All that water, where did it come from? How did it rise up and cover all the land masses? And after the flood, where did it go? Remember, we're not talking about a little bit of water here. The Bible says it was enough to cover the tallest mountain peak by 20 feet.
The first chapter of Genesis specifically describes a firmament or atmosphere which God created around the earth.
In describing the waters above the firmament, Scripture suggests that in the time before the flood, there was a canopy of water vapor around the earth, much like thick clouds of rain, which helped to moderate the earth and protect its climate.
The idea of a water vapor layer or canopy surrounding the earth sounds somewhat bizarre, but actually canopies are quite common among the planets of our solar system. Venus and Jupiter and Saturn all have cloud canopies and thick gaseous envelopes surrounding them.
If the Earth once had such a canopy, how much rain could it have produced? Enough for a worldwide flood?
The vapor canopy would have precipitated at most 40 feet of water directly. In addition, water released by volcanic eruptions during the flood would have kept heavy rain falling for 40 days and nights, becoming lighter as our present-day weather regime came into existence.
Our experts have indicated that the great deluge started when the water came from three sources: the subterranean fountains bursting forth, rain coming from the canopy above, and waters from the existing ocean spilling over the land. But what would have sparked this series of incredible events? One prominent theory suggests we look for an answer beyond the heavens.
It's clear from observations of the moons and planets of the solar system that many of them have undergone periods of heavy meteor bombardment. Even on the Earth, with its higher erosion rates, over 100 ancient impact sites have been discovered. It is certainly plausible that one of these resulted in a series of cataclysmic events leading to the Great Deluge.
As a specific cause of the flooding and the violent earthly upheavals, the meteor theory ranks among the most plausible. To explore this subject further, we turn to the retired director of one of the Defense Department's major research and development laboratories, Dr. Walter Brown.
We can see on our planet 17 very strange features which can now be systematically explained as a result of a cataclysmic global flood whose waters erupted from subterranean chambers with an energy release exceeding the explosion of 10 billion hydrogen bombs. This explanation shows us just how rapidly major mountains formed. It explains the coal and oil deposits, the rapid continental drift, why on the ocean floor there are huge trenches and hundreds of canyons and volcanoes. It explains the formation of the layered strata and most of the fossils, the frozen mammoths, the so-called ice ages, and major land canyons, especially the Grand Canyon. The pre-flood Earth probably had only one very large supercontinent covered with lush vegetation. There were seas and major rivers. The mountains were smaller than today's, but perhaps 9,000 feet high. According to the hydroplate theory, the pre-flood Earth had a lot of subterranean water, about half of what is now in our oceans. This water was contained in interconnected chambers, forming a thin spherical shell about half a mile thick, perhaps 10 miles below the Earth's surface. Increasing pressure in the subterranean water stretched the crust, just as a balloon stretches when the pressure inside increases. Failure in the crust began with a microscopic crack which grew in both directions at about 3 miles per second. The crack, following the path of least resistance, encircled the globe in about 2 hours. As the crack raced around the Earth, the overlying rock crust opened up like a rip in a tightly stretched cloth. The subterranean water was under extreme pressure because of the weight of the 10 miles of rock pressing down on it. So the water exploded violently out of the rupture. All along this globe-encircling rupture, fountains of water jetted supersonically almost 20 miles into the atmosphere. The spray from this enormous fountain produced torrential rains, such as the Earth has never experienced before or after. The Bible states that all the fountains of the great deep burst open on one day. And it describes these events about 5,000 years ago, which we can now tie together scientifically. Some of the water jetting high above the cold stratosphere froze into supercooled ice crystals and produced some massive ice dumps, burying, suffocating, and instantly freezing many animals, including the frozen mammoths of Siberia and Alaska. The high-pressure fountains eroded the rock on both sides of the crack, producing huge volumes of sediments that settle out of this muddy water all over the earth. These sediments trapped and buried plants and animals, forming the fossil record. This erosion widened the rupture. Eventually, the width was so great that the compressed rock beneath the subterranean chamber sprung upward, giving birth to the mid-oceanic ridge that wraps around the earth like the seam of a baseball. The continental plates, the hydroplates, still with lubricating water beneath them, slid downhill away from the rising mid-Atlantic ridge. After the massive, slowly accelerating continental plates reached speeds of about 45 miles per hour, they ran into resistances, compressed and buckled. The portions of the hydroplate that buckled down formed ocean trenches. Those that buckled upward formed mountains. This is why the major mountain chains are parallel to the oceanic ridges from which they slid. The hydroplates, in sliding away from the oceanic ridges, opened up very deep ocean basins into which the floodwaters retreated. On the continents, each bowl-shaped depression or basin was naturally left brimful of water, producing many post-flood lakes.
The demonstrations you have just witnessed of a massive worldwide catastrophe in antiquity supports the biblical story of the deluge in every detail. The challenges of Mount Ararat, even for the professional climber, are formidable. The search for the Ark, in purely physical terms, can be both enormously difficult and highly dangerous.
It's difficult enough to fight the elements in scaling Mount Ararat in search of the Ark. But the political conditions in these parts can often be as unpredictable as the mountain itself.
Anyone traveling to Turkey to search for the Ark is putting their personal safety at considerable risk.
To understand this part of the world is to understand a very complex political situation, which is composed of many regional population groups. This part of Turkey used to be known as Armenia. In the beginning of the communist era in Russia, over 200,000 Armenians were wiped out by the Bolshevik regime. The present situation in this area is still very volatile. Two sides of the mountain face hostile neighbors, Iraq and Iran. And even the lower elevations of the mountain are occupied by terrorist groups of one type or another. Plus, Kurdish terrorists have been known to give expeditioners a great deal of trouble, robbing them and threatening them with death.
Since 1978, educator John McIntosh has been on 8 expeditions to Mount Ararat.
On this particular day, we had climbed up to the 13,500-foot level on the south face of the mountain and proceeded to set up camp for the night. And we heard a lot of noise. I couldn't understand what they were saying, but it was pretty clear they wanted us out of our tents. The other people in our group were being ordered out, too.
I can't be out.
They hauled out everything we had and pulled aside our cameras and any other valuables they wanted to keep. They proceeded to torch everything else they didn't want. Thousands of dollars worth of scientific and climbing gear gone up in minutes. They had everybody in our group move back into a line. At that instant, it didn't really dawn on me what was taking place until I looked up. I can tell you this, there was a lot of praying going on right about then. We really pretty much thought this is it. We didn't wait around for them to have to tell us twice. Needless to say, we were pretty happy to get out of there. I guess you'd have to say we were pretty lucky too, These guys were a very tough group. After everything was reported, the Turkish military sent in about 500 troops into the mountain. One terrorist escaped, another was captured, the rest were shot and killed in a gun battle with the soldiers.
When our discovery of Noah's Ark continues, first-hand eyewitnesses tell their amazing stories.
When I was standing, it looked like a big piece of blue rock. And then we moved back, and then we could see in the end of it. And you can see the different partitions, the different floor levels. You can see cages, corrals, or pens. It was awesome.
Eyewitness sightings of the Ark on Mount Ararat have taken place. It's interesting to note that in each of these cases, the sightings were accidental. These people did not set out to locate Noah's Ark.
In 1959, we were flying jet fighters over Mount Ararat at around 350 knots at about 3,000 feet over the terrain when we spotted what was said to be Noah's Ark. I didn't think of it as Noah's Ark at the time. I wasn't aware of the biblical story placing Noah's Ark at Mount Ararat. It appeared to be a barge-like structure, a large boxcar-type design, and it appeared to be sticking out of a mountain in a kind of a horseshoe depression, and it definitely appeared to be man-made.
During the terms of four U.S. presidents, from Nixon to Reagan, I always flew aboard Air Force One as a UPI White House photojournalist covering the activities of the president. On this particular occasion, I was flying aboard with then-President Jimmy Carter. We were en route from Poland to Tehran, Iran, to attend a New Year's Day celebration given by the Shah. During the flight while we were over eastern Turkey, our attention was called to the window. It was a dramatic moment as Soviet MiG fighter jets were escorting us wing on wing. At the same time, someone told us if we would look down, we would see Noah's Ark. I looked. There, maybe halfway up the rugged mountain, was a large dark boat, clearly visible. It was partially covered with snow or ice. I'm convinced, based upon what I saw there, it was Noah's Ark.
From the air and from the ground, there is, in fact, a growing body of photographic evidence. Pictures which claim to document a large man-made structure high on Mount Ararat. Ray Anderson, a retired aerospace engineer, has climbed Mount Ararat on three occasions and has analyzed photographic enhancements of what he believes is Noah's Ark.
A couple of years ago, I found one slide that had a very interesting object up in the upper right-hand corner. When I looked at this particular object right here under the microscope, it appeared to me that it could be the north end of the long piece. Now, the ark is broken in two. We have conclusive evidence on that from many witnesses. During an earthquake, the south end of the ark, about 100 feet of it, slid down this slope and lodged in a crevasse. So I examined this object, which is only shown in this one picture of the many hundreds that I examined. And under the microscope, I could quite clearly see what appeared to be the roof, or a section of the roof, of what we call the superstructure.
These photos suggest something large, something man-made, is definitely on the mountain. During their long ordeal at sea, Noah and his family had their faith, but very few answers. How long would the floodwaters prevail? Would they find land before running out of food for themselves and the animals?
If there's land out there, she'll find it.
Sent out a dove from the ark to search for dry land which may have surfaced above the floodwaters. But the dove returned having found no place to rest. Later, the dove was sent out again. This time, the dove returned grasping an olive branch in its beak, indicating the floodwaters had receded. The ark was at sea for many long months, waiting for the storm to cease and the floodwaters to recede. At long last, it came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. Now, 8 months after the flood began, other barren mountain peaks became visible. Noah and his family followed God's command and continued to stay aboard the ark for their safety and that of the animals. It was their only shelter and home. It was on the 10th month that Noah climbed to the highest reaches of the ark. There he opened the hatch, which allowed him to reach the roof of the great boat. He climbed onto the roof to be able to see in all directions from where the ark had come to rest. The barren landscape still showed the ravages of the devastating flood. It was to be nearly 60 more days before Noah felt it was safe enough to leave the ark. In all, Noah and his family were aboard the ark for 375 days. And the creatures of the earth were set free once again. Noah's trust in God's commands had been an enormous act of faith. But it was faith well rewarded. Noah and his family were the only humans to survive the great flood. And for Noah's faithfulness, the Lord promised never to bring such destruction again. And for the first time on earth, set a rainbow in the sky, sealing this promise to mankind.
Maybe it's ironic, or perhaps fitting, that those in recent years who have reported being eyewitnesses to the ark are the most average of people from all walks of life. Humble individuals who have no exalted point to prove, no book to sell, no doctrine to foist upon the world. We've located four people who have had unique encounters with Noah's Ark on Mount Ararat. We've sought them out. Not one of them is writing a book about their experience. None preaches from a pulpit. In each case, their experience of seeing the Ark was very moving and highly personal.
It was in 1973 that Colorado resident Ed Bailing became an eyewitness to the Ark. Ed Bailing was a serviceman assigned to a defense installation called Diaberger, located about 100 miles southwest of Mount Ararat. Once there, he struck up a friendship with a Turkish army recruit named Mustafa.
I made it a goal when I left the United States to go to Turkey to see as much as I could. Mustafa and I got along very well. He was in the army at that time about a year. I was talking to Mustafa and telling him how I wanted us to go up and see the Ark. He said he had a great uncle that knew where the Ark was, and his great uncle was going to take us up to it. So I was kind of exciting, you know. Boy, I'm on an adventure. We found ourselves at this old tent, this old camp. Mustafa's great uncle, he knew it all, basically. He was the elder of all. His uncle seemed kind of reluctant to take us up there. You know, I'm talking to Mustafa, he says, you know, well, I convinced him that you're okay.
Locals who live here are very suspicious of outsiders. Without this local connection, this visit to the Ark would have been impossible.
I asked him to take camera, but he preferred that I didn't. He said, Ararat is close to the Russian border, and you're American, I'm Turkish. It could cause some uncomfortable situations. Mustafa's great uncle took us right up the side of this mountain, and we were going around rocks and above cliffs and below cliffs. It was like a trail. He knew exactly where he was going. And I'm tired and I'm winded, and it's, oh boy, when is this ever going to end? When are we going to see the Ark? If we don't see it pretty soon, I want to go back. His uncle turns around and laughs at me, and he points down. And then all of a sudden you look down and here's this huge, awesome ship sitting below you. In this fog, you know, it's almost like a, you know, you picture a dream, and there it is. We walked down around beneath it, and we wound up, I would say, 175, 100 feet below it, because it was sitting on a shelf, a cliff. And we looked up and saw from there, the mouth of it, if we were looking at the end, from the end, it was basically square. However, it was wider than it was tall. The sides were jagged and ripped up a little bit, and I could see what resembled planks. Compared to the hill, the cliff that it was on, it still looked enormous. It's hard to imagine.
And I think about it in my mind's eye, and it's still hard to imagine.
In 1943, another serviceman stationed in the Middle East was Ed Davis. Like Ed Bailing, Mr. Davis was befriended by a young man, a civilian who worked for him over there, named Abbas Abbas. He returned a favor by taking him up to see Noah's Ark on Mount Ararat.
At that particular time, you couldn't see the Ark. When you got where you could see it, he would come back and get me. A couple of months later, he come back. He said, "We can see it, let's go." We were all tied together, about 20 feet apart with a big rope. I was never as cold, as wet, as hungry and tired in my life as I was when I got up there. He was trying to show me the Ark. When I was standing, it looked like a big piece of blue rock. And then we moved back, and then we could see in the end of it. It was awesome. You knew somebody was watching you. There was something going on. I don't know how to explain that feeling, but you knew someone or something. Well, it was just a mighty power someplace there present. It was Noah's Ark.
Ed Davis's overall story sounds very credible. He was told by his guide it was the Ark. He is convinced that what he saw on Mount Ararat was indeed the sacred Ark of Noah. Still, in hearing a story like that of Ed Davis's, it's understandable to be skeptical of these kinds of claims. Author and Ark researcher Larry Williams felt the same way.
When I heard Ed Davis's story of Noah's Ark, I thought not only should I investigate the story, but that I had to personally investigate Ed Davis. I publish a newsletter for treasure hunters and people looking for archaeological sites. As such, I've traveled throughout the world investigating sites and stories. One thing I've learned is you can't trust most of the stories.
What Larry Williams did was hire a top-ranked polygraph expert. Using a lie detector, he decided to test the man's word, integrity, and reputation.
When we return, we'll learn the results of Ed Davis's polygraph exam. Plus, we'll follow in the footsteps of two ark hunters and share their amazing discovery.
Business when he decided he wanted Ed Davis to sit for a lie detector test.
I went to Albuquerque, New Mexico, and hired a top polygraph expert with about 15 years of experience on the police force. I told him the Ed Davis story, and he said, "Larry, give me half an hour with this guy and I'll break him." After two real intense hours, the polygraph expert came out and said, "Larry, I can't tell you what mountain Ed Davis was on. I can't tell you if it was Noah's Ark, but I'll tell you this. Ed Davis saw a boat, and Ed Davis is not lying."
Fate played a big part in the eyewitness account of this man, Dr. Ahmet Ali Arslan. Dr. Arslan is the Washington bureau chief for a major Turkish newspaper and a former broadcaster for the Voice of America radio network. But he knows Mount Ararat like few people do.
My family lives in Aralık, the Turkish town between Mount Ararat and former Soviet Union. I grew up there, and I climbed more than 50 times to the summit of Mount Ararat, including with the many internationally recognized explorers like Fernand Navarra and astronaut the late Jim Irwin. In 1989, I climbed to the northern part of Mount Ararat, which is upper side of Ahura Gorge, the most dangerous side of Mount Ararat, covered with huge glaciers and very dangerous crevasses. Because of my Turkish nationality, I was given permission to investigate on certain areas on Mount Ararat where the others could not go. I went to check a certain area which had been shown in a satellite photo as a possible location of Noah's Ark. I was coming close to the site. Suddenly, the ice and snow began to give away. I ended sliding about 100 feet. It was fortunate that I didn't fall in the crevasses. Otherwise, I would be dead. When I regained my footing, I noticed 100 or 200 feet away, there was a building type of structure, definitely made of wood. It shouldn't be there, just 1,000 or 2,000 feet below the summit. It almost looked like a captain's cabin. I immediately took my camera and shot pictures. You can see straight flat beams and such. Definitely appears man-made structure. My belief is that what I saw and what I took in my photographs definitely, without question, is Noah's Ark.
One of the most fascinating and moving eyewitness accounts ever to surface concerning the Ark is the story of a Christian Palestinian named George Jamal.
Mr. Jamal is an unassuming man, now married and living in California. He is a devout individual whose personal spirit of adventure led him to climb Mount Ararat three times in search of the Ark. His remembrance of the third climb in 1984 brings feelings mixed with both exhilaration and sorrow.
In July of 1984, I returned to Turkey for the third time to look for Noah's Ark on Mount Ararat. I was joined by Vladimir Sobitsky, who returned every year to Turkey to look for the Ark. On this part of the mountain, there were many crevasses, and we had to be very careful. Vladimir was such an expert climber, I was so happy to have him along. The year before, he saw something that looked like a cave high on the mountain. Before he could get to it, an avalanche of ice and rocks closed the opening. Vladimir was quite insistent about trying to find it again. So that's where we were heading. It was almost an obsession. It was all that mattered to us. For 3 days, we looked along the mountain ledge that was covered with ice and rocks. Sometimes the fog would roll in, and we would have to sit for hours to continue on. On the third day, more digging. We dug here, we dug there, we dug everywhere. We moved rocks, we tried to dig in the ice. One time I was hitting a layer of ice with my axe when I heard a hollow echo. I called Vladimir. He came over and we dug and made a hole big enough to crawl through. Inside, it was dark, so we used our flashlight. Then we noticed the walls and the floor were not stones or dirt, but made from wood. Very old, dark wood. It was not a cave at all. We got very excited when we saw part of this room was made into pens, like places where you keep animals. We knew then that we had found the Ark. The room we were in was small, but we could see other rooms with pens and wooden railings beyond, blocked by ice. Vladimir wanted to take a piece of the wood with us to prove we had been there. At first I was worried, I was like afraid. For me it was like going into a church and taking a statue of Jesus. But I decided also, I want to prove I was in the Ark. So we each took a small part of the wood. Vladimir and I had very big plans. We would come back with scientists and movie cameras so that everyone would know that we found the Ark. Outside, we took pictures because we wanted to be able to identify this part of the mountain when we come back. I gave my camera to Vladimir to take my picture. He stepped back to take the picture. And he fell, and that made some noise, and there was an avalanche. It was so deep, I couldn't get to him. And that is where he died. Vladimir and I decided if we found the Ark, we would tell everyone and make it a big deal, big event. But when he died, just couldn't do that. It didn't seem right. You see, Vladimir was the one who insisted we look for the cave. Because of him, we found the Ark. This is a piece of wood which I brought back from Noah's Ark. The wall was so hard, we had to chop, pry, and yank it loose from the inside. To me, this piece of wood is so precious and a gift from God.
It would be hard not to be impressed by the testimony of these five eyewitnesses. They are living people whose stories can be corroborated and directly questioned. Five men who were all on the mountain at different times over nearly half a century, who tell a story that is remarkably the same.
When we come back, the same high-tech foreign satellites that guided our pilots in the Gulf War join our search for Noah's Ark and turn up some breathtaking new evidence. Plus, a startling and unexpected discovery.
Civilian and military aerial sightings of Noah's Ark. We've also presented the modern-day eyewitness accounts of George Hagopian, Ed Bailing, Ed Davis, Ahmad Arslan, and George Jamal. But is there one single factor that all these accounts have in common to help us actually find the Ark for the world to see? The answer is yes. The Ark's location on Mount Ararat. All sightings have been on the north side of Mount Ararat, above the Ahura Gorge.
In an August 1990 helicopter expedition around Mount Ararat, we flew over the glacier on the northeast face of the mountain. At that time, we took this photograph of the rectangular object we believe to be the Ark of Noah.
So we have the photograph shot by the Carl Bau Group where the shape of an object in the glacier could be seen. But we took that a step farther, having the photograph computerized for analysis.
Now we're seeing a computer image of the primary object identified by satellite. As we enhance the computer image of this object, we can see that the object is rectangular in shape. Here, this is the outline. And the object extends over a ledge. In my opinion, this is clearly a man-made object.
Our mystery would already be solved if the Central Intelligence Agency and our Defense Department would only release their reconnaissance photos of spy satellite imagery of eastern Turkey. And why won't they?
They're at the Strategic Air Command, our secret documents right now, which have pictures of Noah's Ark. They're even labeled Noah's Ark on the picture.
We know our government has photos and satellite imagery of that area of Noah's Ark. However, they probably won't want to release that because when they do, they'll also disclose just how good our spy technology has become.
Well, since our government would not cooperate in our search to pinpoint Noah's Ark on Mount Ararat, from France we have imagery from the satellite known as SPOT, the French SPOT satellite imagery taken 555 miles above the Earth's surface, can identify objects down to 10 meters in size. That's about 30 feet. This was a source of photo reconnaissance used by American fighter pilots in the Gulf War against Saddam Hussein. We've brought the latest modern technology into our search for the Ark. Interestingly enough, what may be difficult to make out in photographs taken at a distance of 300 to 500 feet on a fog-shrouded mountain may be identified more precisely and scientifically from hundreds of miles above the Earth with the use of three-dimensional animation. We've taken the French SPOT satellite imagery to a Boston company called TASC. It's an applied information technology firm that specializes in 3D terrain animation. It is at Task that we will continue our search for the Ark at locations pinpointed by satellite. In our animation model, we're approaching Mount Ararat from a couple of hundred miles away. We see Little Ararat in the foreground, and as we approach the two mountains, we're setting our course to fly between them as we go into a circular flight path around Mount Ararat. The animation clearly shows the finger glaciers on the mountain and the deep scar of the Ahura Gorge on the north side, above which the Ark sightings have occurred. The Ahura Gorge is an awesome sight of sheer cliffs all the way up to the Ararat snow line, which continues upward to Ararat's multiple summit peaks. Coming back to the Ahura Gorge across the Abish glaciers, we're going to examine three locations where parts of the Ark have been pinpointed by satellite as well as by eyewitnesses to determine if we can obtain a better visual perspective of the sites. First, we're going to look in this fishhook area on the eastern plateau where Ray Anderson believes the larger piece of the Ark is located. Moving down from about an 11 position on a clock face to a 5 position, we're directly over the site pinpointed by the SPOT satellite and depicted in photos taken on three different successful Ark expeditions. Using the imagery from the SPOT satellite, we will attempt to pinpoint the exact location of Noah's Ark on Mount Ararat, as seen by military satellites, eyewitnesses, and photographers.
In this computer lab, we're now seeing on our computer screen SPOT satellite imagery of Mount Ararat. This S-shaped crevasse is about 1,500 feet long and 90 feet wide. In the middle, we see a defined object extending out of the snow over a rocky ledge. Now in this SPOT imagery close-up, we're able to measure the size of this object. We see here the crevasse with the gray pixels defining a rocky ledge. Extending out of the snow in this area, we see an object coming out over the ledge. Each pixel is 32 feet, so this object is about 80 feet wide and extends out of the snow about 90 feet. According to SPOT satellite imagery and helicopter photo enhancement, this rectangular object is not part of the natural terrain. According to military satellite information, the object is made of wood.
It was at this site that the 1990 Shockey helicopter expedition made another interesting discovery. Expedition member Carl Bau explains.
In late August 1990, our team did 11 separate helicopter expeditions around Mount Ararat. Our advanced satellite information specified this immediate area as being the primary target, and the spectrographic lines indicated that it was of wood.
Now that is an impressive finding, but there is more as we move to the third site, located right on the treacherous upper edge of the Ahura Gorge itself. It is here that experts say there is another broken portion of the Ark protruding from the glacial ice and clearly exposed as the weather permits. It was at this site that several years ago astronaut James Irwin, accompanied by a Dutch TV crew, took our most amazing photograph.
We were in a plane with Jim Irwin on board, flying around the Ararat Mountain, and then flying around the Ahura Gorge. On that particular spot, we did see an object sticking out of the snow cap. It looked like the Ark of Noah. We really got excited, but our time of flying was running out. We had to go back to our base. But some of us were really convinced this could well be the Ark of Noah. So on that very last expedition ever made, that got all the permissions of the Turkish government, finally, that afternoon, we think we saw Noah's Ark.
James Irwin didn't want to announce his startling discovery until he could mount a ground expedition to film at the site. Sadly, Irwin died before he could return to Mount Ararat. Astronaut James Irwin's space explorations will be remembered for generations. And thanks to him for providing the world with this most amazing photograph, perhaps we can now consider that Irwin's personal spiritual quest to find Noah's Ark has been fulfilled as well. Just as there are some people who are convinced by the easiest evidence, there are others who are skeptical even in the face of the most conclusive proof. In the case of Noah's Ark, there is a third group of people who no longer need to be convinced.
What I saw is Noah's Ark.
To me, this piece of wood is a gift from God.
It's there. All the people have to do is go up and look at it.
It was awesome. It was Noah's Ark.
You've seen scientific demonstrations, and you've heard the results of a polygraph examination. You've seen the satellite photographs, you witnessed the stories, and heard the personal testimonies. The evidence is now before you. Well protected and hidden away from the world, the remains of a giant boat have been identified on Mount Ararat. Samples of the wood taken from the vessel have been dated to the time when the Bible indicates a worldwide flood occurred. From this and everything we've seen on this program, what conclusion can be drawn?
You can look at all the stories that come out of that community of nations around Mount Ararat, and they seem to have one central thought that surfaces, and that's the story of Noah. All the evidence leads to the fact that that great ship that's been sighted up there on Mount Ararat has to be the Ark of Noah.
This man called Noah demonstrated his faith in epic proportions. Laboring for generations to build the incredible ark, he brought thousands of animals into the ark to survive an impending calamity, which no one in his day could conceivably imagine. He asked his family to believe in him, and in return he rescued not only them, but all of us who have descended from him. This is more than the story of a great boat and a great flood. It is also the story of a great man. Isn't it remarkable how this book, so long cherished almost solely as a treasury of faith and guidance, is suddenly emerging as an uncanny historical document as well? The latest science and modern technology, as you've seen, seem to support the story that the Bible has been telling for some 3,000 years. If the Ark of Noah is in the ice-bound slopes of Ararat, as the weight of evidence seems to indicate, how shall we handle this?